I think we can start, so we don't need to do this. I would like to catch this question. My God, I have a question for the moment in ISOC. Welcome to our second talk, Naseehah number 2. Last week, as a meeting, started the class last week. We talked about Al-Qiyama and the side of the hours in detail. So today, inshallah, our Naseehah number 2. As we say that, we'll be selecting at random any topic that we feel it can touch our spirituality and our relationship with God in line with the Naseehah. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Allah dhikri lahi tatma'innu al-qulub, that with the remembrance of Allah, the soul of the believers becomes so softened and they will be pondered and neglected. So we will be taken away with the life of this world. So I will be selecting those topics that will touch our life in general. And also, I will let it open to all the brothers. If you have, alaykum salam, if there are anybody, you have any topic in your mind that you feel it will benefit the Ummah, it will benefit everyone, you can just bring it to me against the subsequent one. Whoever has any topic that he wants elaborate, he wants the information about that topic, and we feel the topic will benefit everyone in our life, in our social life, religiously, spiritually, part of Aqida, or part of Islamic rulings, injunction in Islam, or part of knowledge in Islam, or part of social life in Islam, or spirituality. So the selection or the choice of the topics are open to all the brothers so that we can contribute. So the topics are welcome by everyone. You should give me in advance so that I can prepare the lecture on it, and because we are going to keep it weekly, inshallah. Today, I have decided to talk on this important topic, repentance, penitence, or seeking forgiveness in Islam, what we call a Tawba. Because the ulama say, "At-ta'ibu min adh-dhanb kama la dhanba lahu." Whoever is repenting on his sin is like the person who never commits sin. And the basic of this is the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that "Kullu bani Adam khata'un wa khayru khata'in at-tawwabun." All the mankind, they are khata'un, they are committing sin. We are all mistaken. We are all doing things one way or the other, mistakenly, wrongly, we are committing errors. But the best among those who commit errors and who commit sin are those who repent. Those the best among the mankind that they are the ones who commit errors are the ones who are repenting. So when something is being talking about repentance, just take it as part of your life. You are human being and you are committing sin day and night. And Allah is there. This is one of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As narrated in the many ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which he fulfilled, that like there's one hadith of Abu Musa al-Ash'ari narrated by Imam Muslim that Inna Allah yadahu bin layl liyatuba musi'un nahar wa yadahu bin nahar liyatuba musi'un layl, that every blessing night Allah spreading his blessed hand so that those that are committing sin in the day, they will repent, they will seek for his forgiveness. And every blessing day, Allah spreading his blessed hand, so that those that they committed sin in the night, they will seek for his forgiveness. And he will not stop doing that until the sun rises from the west. Today, Allah is going to do that. Yesterday he has done that. Tomorrow he will do it. In the night, the day that passed, Allah has done that. That's why another hadith of Buhari and Muslim, the Prophet says, in the midnight, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is descending down to the heaven. The first heaven, Allah will descend down. And he will be making a clarion call. He will be making some, publicly Allah will be announcing clarion call to all his creatures. He will make three consecutive sentence call. The first one, Allah will be saying, "Oh my servant, if there are anyone among my servants that they are seeking for my forgiveness, I am there ready to forgive them. If there are anyone that are repenting to me, I will accept their repentance. If there are anyone seeking, asking, invoking me, making supplications about his worldly affairs, his life in general, I am there to answer his call." The Prophet said, "Except those who Allah honor and bless, they will wake up and make and answer this clarion call. The other people will be taken out of their sleep, or they are doing nothing for Allah. So you are losing." That's why they say, if you can spare 5 minutes in your night, wake up, do something. You are doing it for your own benefit, not for the benefit of someone. If Fajr, starting time is 6 o'clock, for instance, try to put an alarm to wake up 5:45. If you cannot do better than that, at least 5:45 before that Fajr, so that you can perform ablution, at least you can catch 5 minutes before Fajr time, because that is the last part of the night. When you catch that time, it's be coincidentally that Allah already descended on the heaven and making this clarion call, so it will benefit you. My dear brothers, we are all doing this to benefit ourselves and to improve our spirituality. There are three conditions that, since now we know, we have established that all of us are committing sin day and night, and Allah is there to accept our sin, to accept our repentance. There are three conditions the ulama described, stipulated, so that these three conditions must be fulfilled before your forgiveness, before your repentance be accepted by Allah. Imam Nawawi wrote this in his book, Riyad al-Salihina, and also many of the, he said, make the quotation from the ulama, that that three conditions must be fulfilled when you commit a sin between you and your Lord. The first condition is the person should refrain from committing the sin. When you think that you are dwindling with some sin, you are intermingling with some sins that you are committing, then, and you want to repent, the first thing is to do refrain, cease, stop from whatever you are doing. You know that you are doing something wrong and it's against the Allah's commandment. Stop. This is the first condition. Second one, you should feel so remorse on what you have done so far. You should be regretted. You should be sorry for yourself. That, I am regretted. I am sorry for myself and what I have done. This is the second condition. Another one, alama fat, remorseful on what you have done so far. The third condition, you should resolve not to indulge in doing such sin again. You should make yourself, take it as a promise that, okay, inshallah, from now on, I will not commit that sin again. When these three conditions fulfill, then your repentance will be accepted. But if one of them is missed, your tawba will not be accepted. You have to regret, stop what you are doing, regret, and take intention sincerely that you are not going to do it again. This is actually the condition. The first, they say, if what you have committed, the thing you are doing which is wrong, this is between you and another person, not between you and God. These three conditions are when you commit something between you and your Lord. But if you have done something to someone wrong, or instead you have backbited someone, or you culminated his dignity, his respect, you neglected him, you culminated him, or you have stolen, or you have taken some of his property, some of his belongings, then you need the first condition, condition number four. That condition number four is, you have to hand back all the property to the owner. Or if you culminated someone, go and seek for his pardon, to pardon you, because you have culminated him. Or if you have backbited someone, go and seek for his forgiveness. So when you've done that, then it's making full condition. Then your Tawba will be accepted. There's one book, one pamphlet written by one sheikh. The book is called, just a small pamphlet in Arabic, Urid an Atuba Walakinni dash dash dash. That's the name of the book. I want to repent, but Walakinni dash dash. Then in the book he answers the question, what means dash dash dash? Means he says that Walakinni jahaltu ahkam Tawba. I want to repent, but I'm ignorant. I don't know the condition of how to repent to God. Then he make it so explicit to explain all these conditions and the different cases and different episodes when you find yourself in there. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the hadith of Bukhari from the authority of Abu Huraira, he said that, by Allah, I seek Allah's forgiveness and repent to Him more than 70 times a day. Wallahi inni atub ila wa astaghfir lahu fi yawm akthar min 70 marra. He said, by Allah, every blessed day the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he used to seek Allah's forgiveness. The question is here now. We know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, liyaghfira laka Allahu ma taqaddama min dhanbika wa ma ta'akhkhar. The Prophet was already being forgiven on what he has committed so far and what he has not done in future. Allah already forgive him. And yet, he said he used to seek, repent to Allah, seek forgiveness more than 70 times. Me and you, how many times are you seeking forgiveness? How many times you say, astaghfirullah fil yawm? If the Prophet can seek astaghfirullah 70 times, that he has no, he never commit any sin. You that you are committing sin, how many times are you doing that? Ask yourself, answer this question. Second hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, hadith narrated by Muslim from Al-Ghar bin Yasir al-Mazani, he said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya ayyuhan nas, tubu ila Allah, fa inni astaghfirullah wa atubu ilayhi fi yawmin mi'at marra. He said, oh you people, return to Allah and repent unto Him, because I am seeking Allah's forgiveness and repenting to Him 100 times. See, that hadith, he said more than 70 times. This hadith is limited to 100 times. We are more deserved to frequently do istighfar more than uncountable number. Please, my fellow brothers, try to make sure that at least, if you cannot do more than 100, try to do 100 in a day. This is for your own benefit. Even when you are working, you alone, you are going without anybody, you can say astaghfirullah in your mind. Wallahi, it will be great on your mizan, your own camera. And you will see Allah, and Allah will record it. When one Sahabi asked the Prophet to be close to him on the day of Qiyamah, he asked the Prophet, what should I be doing so that I will be your neighbor in Qiyamah? He said, your tongue should not dry off completely from the remembrance of Allah. means you should keep on always remembering Allah. Ask yourself, how many times you are remembering Allah in a day? In another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, also hadith from Abu Hurairah in Sahih Muslim, that إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَقْبَلَ التَّوْبَةَ عَبْدِ. And he says that مَنْ تَابَ قَبَلَ أَنْ تَتْرِ الشَّمْسِ مِنْ مَقْرَبِهَا تَابَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ. Whoever repents to Allah before sun rise from the west, automatically Allah accepted his repentance. Whoever repents to Allah before sun rise from the west, automatically Allah accepted his repentance. Then this is the time now. The sun always now is rising from the east. My brother, use this time before sun comes from the west, that the Tawba is closed. And another hadith of Abdullah bin Umar. The hadith is in Sunan al-Tirmidhi and with Hassan chain of narration. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says that إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَقْبَلُ تَوْبَةَ الْعَبْدُ مَا لَمْ يُغَلْغِلْ. الغلغرة في العربية إذا بلغت الغلقوم. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to accept the repentance, the tawbah of someone, as long as he never reached al-gargara. His soul, what the ulama translate that gargara means, when his soul never reached his throat, his gullet, his esophagus. If your soul never reached that, means if you are not close to dying, then Allah will accept your tawbah. But when your soul already passed that, Allah will not accept. When they said to Tawba, الَّذِينَ يَعْمَلُونَ السَّيِّئَاتِ بِجَهَالَةٍ ثُمَّ يَتُوبُونَ مِنْ قَبْلِهَا أُولَئِكَ تُوبُ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ. Then that is also to show you the importance and the benefit of this Tawba on our thumb. The gravity of your zulm, the gravity of your sin will not make you not to repent, not to seek forgiveness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't think how big you think you committed sin. Don't give up. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَا قُلْ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا قُلْ يَا الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَى أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِن رَّحْمَةِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. You should not give up on the mercy of Allah. Allah is there, is forgiving all sin. يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا all. إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. So don't give up. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri narrated hadith from Bukhari and Muslim. He gave the story of that person who killed 99 persons. 99 people, he killed them, massacred them. He's just a killer. Kill anyone. Later on, his mind becomes soft. He won't repent. But he's thinking that the gravity of this sin is more than Allah to accept his repentance. But yet, he went looking for how he can repent. He was being directed to somebody, one of the island, the so-called island. He asked him, this is what I have done. I killed 99 persons, and I want to repent. Is it that Allah will accept my repentance when I do? That man, he said, no way. You can't. 99, the gravity is too much. If it's one person or two, it's okay. Then he said, okay, since Allah will not accept me, so let me add with you, top up with you to make it 100. Because there's no need, because Allah will not accept my repentance. So he killed him, he become 100. But still, his mind is not, he's so conscious. It's dwindling in his mind. Then he asks to direct him to another person. Then at the end, he told that, yeah, indeed, exactly, Allah will accept your repentance. But with the condition that you have to leave where you are. This is one of what the ulama say, that one of the, when you find yourself, you are living, you are intermingling with the people committing sin, leave the area, leave the people, them, so that Allah will accept them. Don't stay with those who are oppressing themselves, so that when they, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when Allah send his tribulation and bitterness, it will engulf everyone of you. You have to dissociate yourself. take yourself out of there. Then leave this country, go to another country. Then he moved from that city to another city. Then Allah sent the angel of Moses. They took his soul. So at the end, his soul was moving toward, tilting toward the city that he is going, because he made was a good intention to repent. You see that he killed 100% and he never committed any good deed in his life. But he has regretted. He remorse, he's sorry for himself about what he did. And he stopped doing it. And he made the intention not to do it again. And he is moving towards to make his Tawba to be good Tawba Nasuha. And at the end, the Prophet told us that at the end of his life, Allah made him Ahlul Jannah. He entered Jannah directly. Remember, he never did any right thing in his life except that Tawba. So don't look at the gravity of your zulum. By even saying that your gravity, Allah will not accept your repentance, you are committing another sin. This is a sin also. To give up that Allah will not accept my repentance is another sin. And also we remember the story of Ka'ab bin Malik. The hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim, and in Tafsir Ibn Kathir. Also on that surah, Surah Tawbah. وعلى الثلاثة الذين خلفوا حتى إذا ضاقت عليهم الأرض بما ربت وضاقت عليهم أنفسهم وظنوا أن لا مرجع منها إلا إليه ثم تاب عليهم ليتوبوا إنه هو التواب الرحيم. When Allah revealed that, Ibn Kathir and most of the book, Kutub al-Tafsir, they make this and they brought this hadith on that is the long hadith of Ka'ab bin Malik and the Ghazwat al-Tabuk, the Battle of Tabuk. When they went, he absented himself. He thought he didn't participate. At the end, what happened is long hadith. But at the end, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted the tawbah. So in that, he has committed sin by not attending, not going there, walk out initially to go for the jihad, and he turned back with other guys. But when he comes, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, after he came back, they were bringing their excuses. He said, I don't have any excuse. So when you commit sin, don't start giving some flimsy excuses. That will not be save you. You have done that, I have done that. It's a mistake. Say, I don't have any reason. At the end, he has got a lot of consequences. But at the end, Allah has not accepted his story because he has seen his intention. So this will show you how gravity you are thinking. Always be there to accept. Allah may test you, may try you in your life, but you can fast that one. The end justifies the means. If you are sin are being forgiven and Allah accepted your repentance, you are the successful one. I want to highlight something that will help us. Since we know that we are all committing sin and we are sinners, not that the sinner of the other Ahlul Kitab, they say that you are a sinner, so Jesus will come to take, to wash you, to clean you, to about the sin that all the other committed. La tazil wazirat wazra ukhra. No any soul will take the burden of others. Even whatever wa alazil al-insan illa ma sa'a. There's nothing on any person except what he has done. If someone, your father, your wife, your children, whoever committed something, doing something wrong, will not take responsibility. He will take responsibility on himself. Except if you are the one who guided him, then you will get a commission. But everyone on your own. You have your own file, they have their own files. So, that is, because if we are talking about repentance, to penitent, a penitenter, somebody who is committing a sin, who wants to repent, who wants to seek forgiveness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you need to know the ways to follow. The Islam make it to be, the Islam is so merciful. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made mention about something called Salat al-Tawbah, the prayer of repentance. The prayer of repentance. It's very good every human being to know this prayer and to practice it for your own benefit. Abu Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he narrated a hadith in narration. The hadith is in Sunan Abu Dawud, and it was classified Sahih by Sheikh Muhammad Nasiruddin Albani fi Sahih Sunan Abu Dawud. Hadith is authentic. Sayyidina Abu Bakr said that I heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say it. If my min abdin is never dhambal, summa yatatahhar, wa yakum, wa yusalli raka'atayni, wa yastaghfirullah illa ghafarallahu lahu. He said, there is no any human being that will commit a sin. You will regret it about what you have committed. You go and clean yourself, perform the wudu, observe two rak'ah, and seek Allah's forgiveness, except that Allah will forgive you. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam closes and randomizes with one verse in the Quran. Allah says, وَالَّذِينَ إِذَا فَعَلُوا فَاحِشَةً أَوْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ ذَكَرُوا اللَّهَ فَاسْتَغْفَرُوا لِذُنُوبِهِمْ وَمَن يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ وَلَمْ يُصِرُّوا عَلَىٰ مَا فَعَلُوا وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُونَ. That those that are committing al-fahisha, sexual intercourse or illegal al-fahisha, أَوْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ, or they oppress themselves, then they remember Allah. As soon as you committed something as a sin, then later on you regret it. You remember Allah. You remorse yourself. Fasted for all his nobility. Then they seek Allah's forgiveness of their sin. He said, وَمَا يَكْفِرُ الزُّنُوبَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. Who is there better to accept, to forgive the sin except Allah? وَلَمْ يُسِرُوا عَلَىٰ مَا فَعَلُوا. But they have never dwelled. They have never maintained, continued doing that sin. وَهُمْ يَعْلَمُ. While they are knowing. So the Prophet said, when we recited this verse, he said that, so whoever commit the sin and go and perform wudu, pray to rak'ah, seek Allah's forgiveness, Allah will forgive you automatically. How many times are you committing sin? Wallahu, it's better to be doing this always. Not reckless of there are some public sins that you commit, no spiritual in the life. You are not doing your life among the angels. Most spiritual, you are living in this kind of environment, not committed. Our environment is being polluted, it's contaminated with sexual harassment. You see, are seen naked. The nudity, the destitute, everywhere and there. Every blessing day when you are doing your life here, you must do something which is wrong. Now, even if I swear I will not do kafara, when we finish, before you go in your home, you must see naked. It's becoming part of your body, part of your life. You are not even seeing it as sin, because our heart become rotted. See, you remember that verse in the Holy Quran, where Allah Kalla bal ran ala qulubihim ma kanu yaksibun. That ran ala qulubihim. The Prophet explaining what this ran. Allah said, no, yet their qulub, their mind, their soul is being blocked, is covered because of what they are committing. The ulama translated this ran, they say, Atadari man ran? Do you know what called ran? Something, a cover that block your heart? He said, he described it like this. Like, if this is a heart, the heart initially is sterile, it's free, it's clean, it's pure. The heart of every human being, asalan, naturally, is clean. Then, when you commit a sin, Allah will make a dot on zulum, on the center of your heart. Just one dot. This indicates the zulum. The other part is a clean, is a pure of your heart. And your zulum increases, this will be separated. When it reaches, when it covers the whole of the heart, then by then your heart is blocked. By then, you will not accept, you will not do anything that will benefit you. Whatever, you are not even feeling that you are committing sin. You are feeling that it's okay in your life. But what will be reducing this line is tawba. You have to balance between the two. It's reciprocal from the tawba and committing the sin. When you are committing the sin and you are doing a lot of tawba, then it will be cleansing. It will be cleansing. Then that run will be reduced, that dot will be reduced. So that's why we have been asked to be, when someone committed either minor or major sin, then you are there to do a lot of this salat tawba. That salat, it doesn't have time. You can observe any time, even the time while the prayers have been disallowed. The ulama told it, Sheikh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, I think in Majmu' Fatawa, volume 25, that's, he opened something about, talking about some issue of Tawbah and Adal. He made mention about a salat that is sabab. The prayers that they have some reasons behind doing them. He made mention that among those prayers is Salat Tawba. The reason of doing that prayer is when you committed the sin. And the sin is there, you already committed. You are committing it day and night. Then you need to be doing the prayer so that Allah will erase, will clean your sin. So, how can you repent? We say that repent straight away, observe these two prayers, two rak'at, and do righteous deeds that will draw you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because when you are doing it and doing another, a part of this prayer also, commit yourself of doing other righteous deeds. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, they say like giving charity. It helps to clean your sin. Allah said, إِن تُبْدُ الصَّدَقَاتِ فَنِئِمَّاهِ وَإِنْ تُكْفُوهَا وَتُوتُوهَا الْفُقَرَى فَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ وَيُكَفِّرْ عَنْكُمْ سَيِّئَاتِكُمْ. Allah said, إِن تُبْدُ الصَّدَقَاتِ فَنِئِمَّاهِ. When you make your sadaqa, your charity be open, it's something good. But when you hide it as much as you can to take yourself away from riyah, it will be better for you. But by doing that, Allah will erase, will cleanse, will expiate your sin. So based on this, the ulama tafsir say that, so means it's one of the conditions when you are committing sin, you want to repent. Doing a lot of amal al-khayr, good deed, righteous deed, it will help to expiate, to forgive, to repent. Give sadaqa, help somebody. They say like, the hadith of Ka'ab bin Malik, we made mention on the Ghazwat al-Tabuk. When Allah accepted his repentance, do you know what Ka'ab do to make sure that he clearly showed that his repentance is accepted to Allah? Because he was so happy, even the person who came and gave him a glad tiding, Bashir, Bashir, ya Ka'ab, inna Allah qabala tawbatak. That I'm giving glad tidings that Allah accepted your tawbah. Because out of, he was so happy. He said he has by then a garment. But he's wearing, he just took it and gave it to him as a dash, as a gift. Then he went to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He said, oh, the Prophet of Allah, Ya Rasulullah, I want to testify you that for my happiness and in compliment of my repentance, that Allah accepted my repentance, in compliment to make my repentance to be complete, I want you to witness that I have give out the charity. He has one big farm, a garden. He said, I donate this piece of Allah and Allah and his messenger. Compliment to my repentance. The Prophet ﷺ, he never denied him of what he has done, but what he told him that, okay, leave it in your hand, because it's better for you. This is the only land he possesses. And when you give it out, then you will become empty-handed. He said he prepared that because Allah accepted, for Allah to accept his repentance. The Prophet says, okay, keep it with you. I will take some part and give it to the people as a charity. So based on this, the ulama says that one of the conditions, one of the good things that would help your repentance to be accepted, give out, give charity. Do a lot of, double your effort in doing some a'mal al-khayr. It would help you to accept that. There are two conditions the ulama say that prevent your repentance from acceptance. What will prevent your repentance from acceptance is two conditions. All this what we are saying, whatever effort you made, if you fall under this condition, your repentance will not be accepted. The first one is, as we mentioned, in the hadith, in Allah, man taba qabla an tatul shams min maghribiha taba Allahu alayhi. Whoever repents before sunrise from the west, Allah accepted his repentance. So whoever repents after the sunrise from the sunrise from the west, that one is null and void, is invalid. Your repentance will not be accepted. You are too late. And the second condition, ma'alam you get here. As long as your soul never reached to the throne, means as long as you are never close to your death, you are ajal. Whatever you do, the problem is you don't know why are you close to your ajal. You may die tomorrow. It may be too late for you. That's why repent now, because you don't know whether you will reach tomorrow. Because that condition is there. If you are closer, Allah will not accept it. In line to this, conspicuously, ulama added that if someone also found himself, he is committing a sin, but he found himself in a condition whereby he doesn't have the ability to do it anymore. He stopped it, not intentionally, but because he has nothing to do, also Allah will not accept his repentance. For instance, somebody is drinking, he drinks alcohol, always. He is vagabond of the alcohol. Then he wants to repent. But at the end, you can't drink alcohol without having the money, the ability. Then he becomes so poor. He don't have anything to even to buy. Then he says, okay, I should stop this alcohol because I don't have money now. He stopped drinking alcohol not because of Allah, but because he don't have money. He says that repentance is not accepted. Or you are committing zina, you are doing fornication, then you are being caught up with disease. Or you become an old, you don't have energy. Or your body, physically, you are being deteriorated. There's not any woman that will even listen to you. Then you say, okay, I do my tawba, I stop doing zina. It's a total lie. It's not Tawba in the surah. You stop it because you don't have any other means. They say also that one, you get guilty. Because you reach to the condition whereby you have nothing to do. You don't have any other choice except not to do it. Oh, you are stealing the people's money. But you find yourself, now you are being removed from that position. You are no more that, you don't have any chance. All the way is blocked. I say, okay, I do my tawba. But if tomorrow you will get back to another good position, you will go back. This is not a tawba. So you have to know all these conditions that ulama are explaining with regard to that. But there's one good thing in Islam with regard to this tawba. If someone That's why we are not allowing Islam. You should not be overwhelming on someone who won't make a tawba, to make a judgment, total judgment that Allah will not accept your tawba. Someone comes to you, say that I want to repent. Oh, he is remorsing himself. He's feeling so regretted about what he is doing, and he wants to do the tawba. Then you are saying that, the gravity of your sin is too much that when Allah will accept you. Allah will never forgive you. You say, we are making a lot of these mistakes. When you see somebody, you say, Allah will never forgive this one. This one, you are taking yourself in trouble because you are taking the Allah's duty and putting it on you. وَمَنْ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ. It's only Allah that has the power, the authority to forgive the sin. It's not on the hand of any human being. So when you are overjudging someone that Allah will not accept his tawbah, then all your good deeds, the consequences, they will be null and void. They will be abrogated. Allah will spoil them. That's hadith al-Qudsi from the authority of Abu Hurairah. The hadith is in Bukhari and Muslim. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam narrated from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah said that if my servant commit a sin and he regretted it, he won't repent. He is looking for to be so penitent and to seek my forgiveness. Then when someone comes and tell him that Allah will never forgive you, then Allah will say that قَدْ غَفَرْتُ لَكَ وَحَبَطَ عَمَلُكَ. You, that you are looking, you are seeking for my forgiveness, I have forgiven you. And you, that you are saying that I will not forgive him, I have nullified, abrogated, spoiled all your good deeds. What spoil your good deed just by saying that Allah will not forgive you? Because it's a no-go area. Only Allah has that power to say that. So don't make that mistake. What about sometimes you will see someone in the situation wherever he will commit sin and repent, regret, tomorrow will go back again. Repent, regret. Another day he will come back again. It's like he is playing with your intention. If you are to judge someone, you ask him not to do something, you are the leader, or under your control, in your custody, your children, your wife, your servant, your followers are doing something, say, please, this is the last warning, do not do this again. Please, I am seeking for pardon us. We see this is the life of the human being. Then tomorrow you'll come back. You'll do it again. You see tomorrow. Are you not the one that you have brought yesterday? And today also you are committing it. It's like you are playing with our intelligence. I have pardoned you. I forgive you and you do that again. You are not serious. But jail him. Kill him. Clear out from my sight. This is the nature of a human being, but it's a reciprocal to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is doing the opposite out of his mercy. If somebody will come and commit a sin today, tomorrow you seek for Allah's forgiveness, or right away you regret. First step from losing, then you seek for Allah's forgiveness. When you fulfill all the conditions, when Allah forgive you, after something you will go back again. You see, it's not Tawbah and Naseehah. Repent to Allah, the actual, the real repentance. Without doing delay. Then Allah says that, when you come back, Allah says that, my servant, he committed sin. He is seeking for my forgiveness. He repent unto me. I forgive him. he committed again. He repented unto me, I forgive him. Allah, out of his mercy, you say that my servant knows that I am the only one who is forgiven. Still, my servant, I forgive you. You are doing it times after another, but Allah will continue, will not get tired of you. You say that I forgive you. The khata, the trouble you will find yourself here is that time that you committed, before you repent, Allah may accept, may take your ajal will come, you will die. Then, summa awalu, summa kafaru, summa awalu, summa kafaru, summa zaatul kufara. Then you are finished. But as long as you are committing the sin, you are seeking for Allah's forgiveness, Allah is there to forgive you. That's why when that a woman, a lady was brought during the lifetime of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, who committed zina, she compares herself, she brought herself al-Ghamidiyya, Imra'at al-Ghamidiyya. She came purposely, intentionally, reported herself to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that, oh, Prophet, I came alayya haddad. Do justice to me. Judge me according to the Islam. I committed a sin. I committed a zina. Nobody saw her. Then the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam turned his face out of her silence. She turned this another side of the Prophet. He turned. He don't want to see her. Three times. The letter on. The ulama said that like, Prophet wanted her to testify herself as a witness three times that she committed because nobody said there was no witnesses. He said, okay, take her because she was impregnated. She has, she become pregnant of that thing that she had done. Prophet said, okay, take her, let her go under her custodian, her relative, her guardian. When she gave birth, when she delivered, brought her back. Then they go, they take her out. When she delivered, she brought herself back. That, oh, Prophet, here am I. I have delivered, this is a new baby. Please judge me. Do hajj on me. Some ulama were even saying that Prophet, when he said go, he is giving her chance, allowance to go. When you repent, it's okay, you tell them to come. But she brought herself back with the baby. And she knows that her hukum is rajab to throw her to death. Then the Prophet says, go nurse your baby. Go and nurse your baby. You are in the weeded period. When you finish nursing the baby, come back. She went and she come back. See, three different incidences. She brought herself back because she went what? Tawba. She went to repent on her own self. Then the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said that now, three times all these episodes happen, then he make an arrangement to go and throw her to death. Because she married, she is not a virgin, she was already this virgin. So her hukum is to stone her to death. Then they start stoning her. The plash of the blood split and touch Umar. Umar, he cast on her that, are you a zani, a fornicator, a prostitute, your blood will touch my man. The Prophet said, how are you saying that and some of the other? Because the Prophet said, stop. Do you know that she has repented? She seeks Allah's forgiveness that her repentance will be equated. It's equivalent to distributing to 7 mu'min believers in Madinah, and it will be sufficient for them, it suffices them to enter Jannah. The level of her repentance, when you divide it, is enough for Sahaba, 70 Sahaba to enter Jannah. See how merciful Allah. Somebody who commits something and he repents. Wake up in the night, my brother. Pray to Rakat. Ask Allah, oh Allah, you know that I'm doing that. Allah forgive you. lie. Allah is so happy. So dear. You see, I'm doing. But how many are doing? Have you believed that you are not committing sin? Or do you believe that your work will enter your gender? Then the last thing I want to conclude is one issue. What about if someone did the righteous deed while he is carrier or fasting or an innovator or somebody who is witchcraft? He is doing witchcraft, he is practicing witchcraft or any form of this amal that is not according to Islam. Or somebody who is hypocrite, monarchic. Or a lot of this. Or somebody who is doing the show. You have committed, you have done something good. Maybe somebody is kind before. And he did a lot of, he is helping others. He is so kind to the people. He assists, he gives charity. But later on, he becomes Islam. Or when, due to your youthful exuberances, you commit a lot of sin in your youthful age, you are doing that, you say, ah, let me enjoy my life, I'm youth, I'm not yet married. You say, this mostly happen in some of the, not in like African countries, sorry, I'm not racist, but I'm saying because I've seen most of it in the sub-Arab or Asian countries. Somebody will not go to Hajj till when you say that you are old. If you are youth, they are so surprised when they see youth to go Hajj. They say, ah, means when you go Hajj, they have that notion that if you come back from Hajj, so your sins are being forgiven. So it means you have deprived your life from enjoying. So it means you will not go back and commit any sin. Allow yourself when you are old. Then when you come back from Hajj, sit down and continue doing istighfar. You will finish enjoying your life. This is a decline mentality that the people are doing. So you committed and now you want to repent. What about the good deed you have done before? Or why still you see somebody who is wicked, who is crazy, or who is capable, or who is passive, or who is managing, but still he will have something good doing to the others. Will that benefit him when he repents or not? This is very important something. I have read in the Musnad Ibn Abi Shayba. I was compiling some hadith last during Ramadan. On that, I'm studying that book, Musnad Ibn Abi Shayba. It's a very big book of hadith. I compiled like almost 20 or 30 hadiths talking about this. He made a chapter talking about this. And there's hadith in Bukhari also in Muslim. From the wife of Hakim bin Hizam. Hakim bin Hizam, when he came, he was not a Muslim before. He accepted Islam later in the life. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then he was so wondering, so annoyed that, oh, the Prophet, I knew why I was kafir before I accepted Islam. I'm very kind to the people. I established the bond of relationship, my kin and ties. I'm doing a lot of salat al-rahim to his relatives. I give charity a lot. This is my habit. And I manumit a lot of slaves. I buy the slave, I enslave them, I free them. And I am buying food, giving it to the poor and fukara, needy and poor people. All this that I have been doing it for many years, for 20 years, in the ignorance during the Jahiliyyah period. Now, Prophet, I accepted Islam. And all this I am doing, they are part of what the Islam is teaching. Will this good deed benefit me now Or means I have to come back from the square one to start another one.
The Prophet said, indeed, أَسْلَمْتَ عَلَى مَا أَسْلَمْتَ مِنَ الْأَمْرِ مِنَ الْخَيْرِ.
You have become Muslim alongside with all the previous good deeds, good virtues you have committed during Jahiliyyah. Allah will take it and send it to you, it will record it. It will not be wasted. لا إن الله لا يهدي وأجر من أحسن عملا. Allah will never destroy, neglect the right deed, the good deed of those who have done it. So the ulama, Ibn Taymiyyah in Majmu' Fatawa, Ibn Qayyim Jawziyyah in his book Al-Wabil Sayyid Min Al-Kalim Al-Tayyib, Sheikh Abdul Aziz Ibn Baz in his Fatawa, Sheikh Uthaymeen, Sheikh Sa'ad Al-Ghani, they are all mentioned this, that if someone, maybe he is doing some hypocrite acts, or he is in the middle, he is doing a lot of things that are against Islam, or he is doing a lot of something that are fasad or fasad, or he is kafir, or he is doing something as a show of riya, later on he regretted, he realized these are all mistakes, not good in Islam. Allah guided him to the right path. He do tawbah and nasuha. He do good tawbah, repent, seek for Allah's forgiveness. What you have done during that time, Allah will take it according to give it to you. But if someone die, it will not be useful for him because Allah says, وَمَا مَنَعَهُمْ أَن تُقْبَلَ مِنْهُمْ نَفَقَاتُهُمْ إِلَّا أَنَّهُمْ كَفَرُوا بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَمَا تُهُمْ كَفَرُوا. If someone, a kafir, who did something good, whatever he did, Allah will not accept it from him because he is not a believer. The condition to accept your good deed is you become a believer and do it with righteous deeds. But yet, if you didn't fulfill this condition, the religion or whatever, to do something in conformity with what the Prophet says and does, and with sincerity of purpose, with ikhlas, Allah will accept your deed. But you have done it, maybe no sincerity, or it's not according to what the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did, or you are not even Muslim. But if they are recorded, but it will not be useful for you. But now when you repent, Allah will take it back and top it up to your present good deed, so that it will benefit you. You will not lose it. Wallah, you will not lose it. You will find it in your kitab, in your files of doing good deeds. That's why it's good for you always to be established, doing good deeds in your life and repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on what you are doing. And the time is complete. Inshallah, I will stop here. This is just a reminder that I did it to me, myself, and my fellow brothers. And at the end, I will conclude it with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah An-Nur. فَقُلْتُ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفَّارًا يُنَزِّلُ السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِدْرَارًا وَيُمْدِدُكُمْ بِأَمْوَالٍ وَبَنِينَ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ جَنَّاتٍ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ أَنْهَارًا مَا لَكُمْ لَا تَرْجُونَ اللَّهَ وَقَارًا وَقَدْ خَلَقَكُمْ أَطْوَارًا. Good to understand the translation of this, but Allah said, you should be seeking for Allah's forgiveness, repenting unto Him. Inna Mugara Kafara, indeed Allah is the forgiver. You receive Sama alaykum midalara, after month, the consequence, the benefit of this, Allah will be sending the rain from you. Alaykum midalara, the water. Bless water that will benefit you and the other creatures. Where you did it be amwali wabani. And Allah will increase you with amwali wabani, wealth, richness, and the children. You are complaining about poverty, do istighfar. You are complaining about children, do istighfar.
you are complaining about the dry up, drought. Do the istighfar. Which Allah can tell that what Allah and have. Allah will make it so easy to do. Guide us. The rivers will be flowing. Malakum la tarjuna Allah. Why? La tarjuna Allah. Can't you go back to Allah? وَكَنْ خَلَقَهُ وَقَتْوَارَ As Allah already, He created you. One after the other, He created you with Himself alone. أَلَمْ تَرَوْا كَيْفَ خَلَقَ اللَّهُ سَبَقَ Allah is showing us. So there are a lot of benefits between Tawba or repentance. Only Allah knows the benefit. سَلَبْتِ أُنَّ فِي هَذَا لَذِكْرَ لِمَنْ كَانَ لَهُ قَلْبٌ أَوْ أَلْكَسَّمْ وَمَشَجِيلٌ السلام عليكم.
First one is that the four conditions that you mentioned of Tawba, that if you have done something bad, you'll be able to tell them. Like some scholars also mentioned that if it's going to bring more enmity between you two, then it's better to avoid this. So,
what I will say is that, like Imam al-Nawawi, in his book, the Hadith Sahihina, chapter 2, the Bab al-Tawba, and also in the Dalil al-Fadina, volume 1, Ajr al-Dawt al-Muttaqin, volume 1, and that book of Ibn Taymiyyah in volume 25, Majmu' al-Fatawa, Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah, in Al-Wabil al-Sayyid, Min al-Kalim al-Tayyib, and in another book, Al-Igathat al-Lahfani, Min Makaid al-Shaytan, second volume, they made mention. And that book will read an atuwa like any jata ahkam al-tawba. If somebody you committed, you culminated someone's dignity or prosperity, and you have done something to him wrong, and you want to repent to him, if you have something in possession, you have to hand it back. If it's not something in possession, but you have backbited, or you culminated his dignity, then you should seek for his pardon or forgiveness. But it may put you yourself in the situation whereby you have done something for someone wrong, and now you don't know whether he is alive or not, or whether he is in this world, or you are not in the same place, in the same area or country with him. Then the ulama says that you can give something out of charity, that may Allah take the reward to him, to benefit him. Or you can continue seeking Allah, because the condition is you have to seek Him. If there's no way to reach Him, then you can seek Allah, that Allah, you know that I have tried my best to reach this one, I cannot, or Allah forgive me. Like that. If it will increase the enmity between you and Him, maybe you have done something to Him, then you want to go and say, okay, Thayyid, I remember that last time I done something to say that, this one, so you are the one now, so I will. You will become my great enemy. If you will not understand, he says, try to find out the way that you can send him this without knowing. And you don't stress that, emphasize that, no, I have to know, because you can send, write a letter, send him a text that, oh, brother, please, bro, I have done something, so please, can you forgive me? Some you say, we have to have this, that, no, I'm not, tell me, what have I done to you now? You don't need to know. He says, please forgive me, I regret it. Or I have done something, but I am feeling ashamed to come and ask you, please, you can pardon me, forgive me. Or send someone that you know that they are in good time, that he can lobby him, he can tell him. Whatever, in that case, what they are saying, that is the first condition. If it's something between you and him, Allah will not forgive you the same between you, the human being, except when that one overlook it. So try to make sure that you have get something between him, inshallah. This is what you're saying.
The pamphlet, where can we find that pamphlet? I want to look at it.
I have read it 10 years back. I have it back in Nigeria. We read it at Tawba, like in Egypt, I come and over.
You should be able to get maybe PDF or something.
Yeah,
PDF.
I read it 10 years back.
Islam PA, if I'm not wrong. Take Al-Munaji. Because he has something similar as well.
Okay, there are many books like that, but
vividly I can recall, I read that one, and it's just small book, but it's in Arabic.
Yeah, that was they translated.
Okay, yeah. I want to repent, but dash.
What about regarding the prayer of repentance?
Yeah.
What about the sins that you had committed in the past? Can you pray now for those sins?
Yeah. That's why they say the prayer doesn't have time.
Okay.
What you have committed 10 years, 100 years back, you recall it now, you can pray now. You committed something now, yesterday, you can pray now. As long as you never reach your death, you can do that prayer. So you can combine all, you can make an intention that, okay, today I want to do, before I sleep, I want to do Salat al-Tawba. Just it will not take you 5 minutes, mashallah, but upon ablution. Pray 2 rak'ah. There's no specific surah, no specific time. Any surah of your choice, recite Fatiha and surah. After you finish the prayer, and there's no any supplication, there are some hadith, but weak chance of narration that they brought some Azkar special supplication to do attached to this. In the hadith narrated from the Sunan Abu Dawuda, from the authority of Abakar, there's no specific supplication to do. Just when you do that, with that intention, pray 2 rak'ah, recite surah of your choice, do istighfar, as much as you can, there's no number at time, seek Allah to, oh Allah, forgive me. You can sum it up, all the sins from the time you become balik, from your maturity to date, I want to repent Allah to my sin. Allah is not accepting. Please, I want all my brothers to practice this today, before you sleep. Because we agree that all of us were sinners. We have a lot of things that we have committed. So let everyone, before you sleep today, do this. It will benefit you.
And also about that prayer, there is in one other narration, there is one more condition mentioned, that when we are praying the prayer, we shouldn't be thinking about the things of dunya. That we shouldn't, those things shouldn't, we should be focused on that prayer.
Yeah, but khushu is always an issue.
All, any kind of prayer you are doing, the khushu is there. You're supposed to have that. No, but it's not condition attached to that. The hadith never mentioned that.
Okay, and this question is, what about if you do wrong to the non-Muslims, and how can you go and reconcile back on them? And suppose maybe if it was maybe the Muslims, you didn't find them anywhere, you can make dua for them, maybe you can give charity
the
for them,
and
so on.
As long as someone is human being, we are all the same on the side of Allah. So you cannot, whether you cheat a Muslim or non-Muslim, or a kafir or a munafiq, whoever you cheat, Allah is going to judge you according to the judgment if you never repent. So if you do something wrong, mischievous to somebody who is not Muslim also, Allah will hold you responsible. So you have to, even if it's non-Muslim, the same way to do to the Muslim, repent, the same way to do to the non-Muslim. I think we can. Other questions because of time. Inshallah, this week, by this time, I'm going to take another topic. And as I said earlier, that the topics are open. Or anyone can bring any topic of his choice that you feel it will benefit us. So in advance, I can prepare the talk on it because we are going to do this next year weekly. So inshallah, anything either spiritually, religiously, pickable, aqidah, tawheed, hadith, knowledge, whatever in Islam, you can bring this to Inshallah. Assalamu alaikum.